Good night.
Night, officers.
Good night.
Technically, the glove said you get to miss it.
Seriously, just forget about it.
We are the awkward situation. That makes
sense. Just break it down, yeah!
So, we are some dumbass 20-something.
Guys, thanks for joining us for another episode of The Roster. I'm Annmarie, and this is my beautiful and wet co-host, Echo.
Hello! We have such an exciting episode for everyone today because we are actually bringing on
a guest.
A guest, a very special guest, and she's a pornographic actress, but the biggest surprise is that she was my adolescent mentor in high school as well. I really looked up to her for many, many years. Like, she
no
was,
surprises there, right?
She was genuinely like a crucial part of my development as an adolescent. I did theater and she did as well. And she's an incredible singer. And I always wanted to be just like her. And so now she
You're on your way.
She does porn now, and she's really good at it. Annmarie and I
both. She's hot.
Yeah, we've seen her porn. I've definitely masturbated to it.
Yeah, guilty. I made it a goal to do it before she was on here.
That's so awesome. Actually, I was masturbating earlier today, and I was like, what should I masturbate to? And I was like, well, we're having her on the show, so I feel like I should be masturbating to her today, right?
So good.
So anyway, her name is Lisey Sweet, and we are going to bring her on for you right now. Okay, everybody, say hello to Lisey Sweet.
Hey, girl. And also say hello to her nipples.
Okay, so we're going to start off really basic and just ask, how did you first get involved in the industry? And, like, at what point did you know that's what you wanted to do?
Okay, so how did I first get involved in the industry? Well, you guys knew me when I was younger. I guess I considered myself a sexual person, somebody who liked to be sort of free and open, push the limits a little bit. And when I met my now husband a little over 10 years ago, we kind of started experimenting a little bit with open types of different types of relationships, open relationship.
Which is like the only type of relationship to have, by the way.
Exactly, in my opinion, yes.
Yeah.
So we kind of started doing a little bit of that, but like one of the things that was really exciting to me was the exhibitionist portion of it, being able to kind of be sexy in front of other people. And anytime I saw, I guess this is sort of like one of the examples I like to use. Anytime I went to a strip club and I saw strippers, I always sort of like envied like what they were doing. I'm like, here I am. Now I'm, an accomplished scientist sitting here all nerdy and like feeling like, ugh, watching these hot girls up here just like rolling it in because they are like looking amazing. And it just kind of was that mentality with the encouragement of my husband to like really be part of that. And I always had an interest in erotic photography, any kind of erotic art. I've got it all over my house.
I love that.
And yeah, so I guess it kind of started, our first Fantasy Fest was in 2014. Fantasy Fest is a festival that's kind of adult charged in Key West, Florida. And basically people are body painted or wearing lingerie at all these parties. And it's kind of one big, a little over a week long, like adult Halloween party. And so that's kind of where it started. And I had realized the second year that we had gone that a lot of the amateur photographers that go there had taken pictures of me the first year and didn't know who I was. And they were like, who's this girl? Who's this girl? And so then they wanted to start doing photo shoots. And I was like, how much do I have to pay for this? And I'm like, no, it'll be free. So then we kind of started doing modeling on the side, erotic photography, things like that. And he came across an opportunity. Sorry, he's sitting here. He came across an opportunity for some video work. And he was sort of like, what do you think? And I was thinking, that sounds really exciting, but we have to consider a lot of things. You know, once the Pandora's box is out of the box, you can't put it back in. But it was a really exciting opportunity for us to think about expressing ourselves sexually like that. So we understood the risks involved, that family, friends, workers, coworkers, employers, everybody would potentially eventually find out about it. And we decided that our desire for expression was greater than the risk. Mm-hmm. So I did my first amateur video when I was living in Georgia in 2016, right? I think 2016. Yes. And then just started gaining popularity and
social media.
Wait,
what was your first video like? I'm so curious.
Okay, so my first video, what was my first video like? We were in some guy's basement in Georgia. And
Seems safe.
Right, totally safe. And we had met these people in advance, and the assistant to the guy that was running this company is now one of my best friends. I was actually just texting her before this, and I was the maid of honor in her wedding. So like, we are very close. She's not with them anymore. The company doesn't exist anymore. But, you know, so she was kind of one of the people that like met with us and was like, we are a legitimate company. Like, it's not, you know, I'll be there and all of that stuff. So yeah. There was comfort.
Right. So you were safe.
Yeah. And my husband was there the whole time. That's so,
and super cool, first, obviously. Yeah. For you. Cool.
Yeah. It was exciting to have him there, and I wouldn't have had it any other way.
Yeah.
So the first scene was interesting because I remember the guy was a little weird. He had like all of this stuff all over his fingers. I don't know what he was doing, but he was kind of off the rails. And I was like, all right, whatever, this guy. But I was so nervous. I was like, I don't know if I can do this. Oh my God. And they were just giving me instructions. And it was so much. And I was like, I don't know if I can do this. And then we started. And as soon as it was like action, it was like, all the lights on stage were on you, and I knew what to do. And I felt this like rush that was like, holy shit, this is it. And I remember it just being such an amazing experience. And when I was finished, I'm like, this is what I need to do. And so, I loved it so much, even though the guy was kind of weird. I remember having this like really emotional kind of, and I've had that after some scenes that were really intense for me. This kind of overwhelming emotion to know that this is what I really wanted to do and kind of like my calling in essence.
That's pretty awesome, because I think a lot of people have the assumption about other people who do porn that they're doing it not because they enjoy it, for like any reason but enjoying it.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Like the last thing you think of is, yeah, that it turns you on.
it's not fair at all. And honestly, I think that like my favorite porn is usually involving people who are enthusiastic and are actually genuinely like enjoying doing those things and pushing those limits. So that's interesting to me, definitely.
So what's the industry like though? Is it like, is it kind of cutthroat? I always imagine it's pretty intense.
So the industry is, I would say it's pretty cutthroat. When I was kind of starting to try to go mainstream, it was nerve-wracking. At the same time, I was in a science job. I was still a research scientist at the University of Georgia at the time. So I was trying to balance the two while keeping it kind of secret in
right,
some
which
ways.
Which must be really difficult.
It was. So it was very difficult at the time. But yeah, I mean, it was kind of like it's always this hustle to try to talk to people and get noticed. But at the same time, like sort of as you're approaching the professional realm, there's a lot of people out there that, you know, don't either don't want to pay your rate, or you kind of are thinking in your head, well, maybe I should do this for a lower rate because I'll get recognized. So there's there's a lot of things that were kind of difficult along the way that we had to make decisions on. And I think that we always made the right decisions, whether to work with somebody or not, or whether to do this, to try to increase your brand and get to a point where you are recognizable and desirable and to go to the next step. As far as guys, it's even more cutthroat. Really? There are a lot less guys in the industry, and the things that they have to do are just amazing. It's not just about having a big cock. It's about getting hard, staying hard through an entire scene. It could be like a 14-hour day that these guys need to just get on it hard when it's ready.
Yeah.
And then not come until they're supposed to. Be in crazy awkward positions. Sometimes they'll be paired with talent that they don't get along, they don't really like each other very well, or that there's not good chemistry. Some of them will be like in all of these, just like one leg up and you're cramping.
No, you have to have some muscles for all the like picking up you have to do.
Yeah, I'm actually suffering from some abdominal pain today from some stuff that I did recently. So I'm like, ooh, you know, as I get older, I'm like, I can't do all this crazy stuff anymore.
So obviously you did have a good job before this. You were doing something, and I remember we had conversations about it. I know you were a little less passionate about the science work than you were about some of the musical theater and performance stuff that you were doing prior to that. And so do you think that it's been worth it to make that change?
Absolutely. I mean, every day I wake up sort of, I can't believe that this is my life. Like, pinch me, I must be dreaming. You know, I went to school for biological sciences. And, you know, you guys know that I was in musical theater. And when I was applying to colleges, I had sort of looked at that. And as much as I really loved it, it was not the life that I wanted to live. That constant starving artist sort of thing, going to New York and that clicky feel. Mm-hmm. I loved performing, but that's not what it was about. Yeah. You know, and when you make something like that a career, it can wear you down. And yeah, that passion goes away. So I had found science and I loved it. I was very good at it. I was very good at managing. And I think I took a little bit of a different mentality approach to a lot of scientific things. So as I got in the right lab, thanks to my husband helping me out, getting me a job.
Man, this guy's and really a bro. Can we see his face for a minute?
They want you to come in.
Like permanently? Just
give us a look for a minute.
If he wants to be there, he can.
If he wants to be there, yes.
Hey!
I can't hear you.
Okay.
I'll just
answer
it.
So he'll just sit here.
That's perfect.
He's the eye candy.
As far as like money goes, is it worth it financially? Was there a big difference for you switching from science?
Well, that's kind of interesting, because when I officially made the switch from science to porn, it was not necessarily my doing at the time. We had talked about it and that we wanted to make the transition. And so I was doing porn and I was still doing my science job, and we were kind of like, you know, we want to make the leap. So it's kind of scary because you don't know if you're going to be successful, if you're going to fail, are we throwing all of this away? I had been in science for 7 years and, you know, had publications. I was in Nature Medicine. So it was kind of like a lot to throw away. And when I was at the University of Georgia, we had a coworker who was disgruntled, I guess, to say the least. And he decided to make a lot of false claims about me to the police of the university. So I was arrested.
Dang.
You guys have that in common,
falsely arrested.
Too.
Yeah, I've been arrested, but not falsely.
Oh, she wasn't falsely. Yeah, no.
Sorry.
Yeah.
No, that's crazy, though. I can't believe that someone would do that.
Yeah, so I was interrogated for like 2 hours, and they thought that I was involved in prostitution and that I was involved in trying to manipulate mentally handicapped people and all of these crazy things. At the end, they were sort of like, she obviously didn't do any of this. All of these things are not true. But I guess the university decided it was in their interest to fire me abruptly.
Okay.
And that they had reported to the Labor Department of Georgia that I was fired for egregious conduct with no specific terms. So that meant that I was never going to be eligible for another government type job, state job, working in education. That's like a big black mark on your record.
Yeah, that's fucked up.
Even though everything that they had found was not true, except for the porn, but you know, I wasn't a contract employee.
Right, and it's like everything you're doing is legal, so.
Yeah, so we had hired a lawyer that had represented Larry Flint before for his free speech, and he helped us kind of work out something with the university that was an agreement to allow me to resign and be on good terms in the event that I needed to get another job in the science world, because that was kind of the concern was, if I wasn't successful, what were we gonna do?
Yeah.
I, you know, that would be a really hard thing. So yeah, so they kind of pushed it for us, put it for us like probably faster than we would have on our own. So I guess the silver lining was that it was sort of sink or swim. And we went for it, and I mean, within
you fucking swam, bitch.
Within a few months, he had found a job out in California, and we moved to LA, and we've been out here for
almost 3 years
now.
Nice.
And right, yeah,
so
almost 3 years. Yeah, and yeah, so I mean, it's going really well, and I don't regret any of it, and I love my job. And now, not only am I performing, but we have a production company, so we're producing.
Nice. Congratulations.
And directing, and
that's
great.
That's badass. Yeah.
Echo's like, drop me that
info. Like, let me just, like, slide in.
So, we've asked about how you got into porn, but, like, now we want to ask the questions. Like, a lot of our listeners want us to ask you some weird shit. So, is that okay if we start asking you the weird shit?
I am so down for weird shit.
Okay, so, so what's a DP like? Does it leave you extremely sore?
I want to know about this desperately. I really do.
So, neither of you guys have ever been DP'd before?
Never!
What is that?
I've never even had a threesome.
Oh, I've
girls, I had threesomes when I was still in high school.
I've had
and that's
threesomes.
That's why I liked you so much.
Okay.
That's why I liked you so much.
No, but for real, I always did respect that a lot in high school. Even like, I know that some people would say negative things about like your promiscuity, and I'd always be like, I feel like that's so badass of her. Like, she's doing what she wants to do.
Fuck
so
yeah.
Yeah, it really was a way that I looked up to you.
Yeah, I guess when I was in high school, I was only a teenager at the time, so I didn't really let those things bother me.
Mm-hmm.
But as you grow older, you tend to wear them like a badge of honor. I don't know if you guys saw on my Facebook, but I posted that one picture where I'm wearing a necklace that says slut on it.
Yes, I love that.
Oh, yes, yeah. I remember that.
Yes. No.
And somebody was like, oh, is this? I tried to pretend like it was my senior picture. And people were like, oh, that's such a nice picture. And they didn't even notice the necklace. And that it was actually... It was actually one of my stills that was from on set for kink.com.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. I love that.
So, what were we saying? Oh, you were asking
the DP,
okay, what's
tell
a DP
me about
like?
The DP.
What's a DP like? Okay, it's fucking amazing. Probably one of the best sensations in the world. If you like anal, a DP is like even better. Because I find a lot of times when I'm doing anal, even though I really enjoy it, sometimes like my pussy gets really hungry. Like I need dick too, but like it doesn't want to give it up. So the nice thing about the DP is it can be a little difficult because if the guys aren't experienced, like the positions can be a little tough, but no worries. You can get it done. There's a lot of ways that you can get it done. It feels amazing to be like stretched in both holes like that and have that closeness. And for me, because of the type of things that I like, one of the most exciting things is like imagining like this action going on.
Yeah, that's always like, the best when I watch porn. Yes, I know exactly what you mean.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, so it's really,
it's hot.
Quite the experience.
So do you have GPs. Do you have like a specialty at all, or do you just kind of do everything?
I do have specialties. Okay. I'm very well known for, I guess, a couple different things in the industry. Let's see. I guess last year, or this past year, for the AVN Awards, which is the like Oscars of porn,
mm-hmm. And I was nominated super hot for that.
Oh, thank you. And AVN. I was nominated for Best Bisexual Scene, Best Anal Scene, Best Double Penetration Scene, and Most Epic Ass.
Nice. So,
nice.
Right. There's a central theme there, right?
The booty.
The booty. So I guess my third scene ever was my first anal scene with Mike Adriano for Evil Angel, and which is really unusual in the industry. Most girls will wait quite a while, and they'll do other things that will build up to an anal scene, but I just kind of went for it. So for my first year, I did almost exclusively all anal scenes. And my, seventh scene ever was double anal. And it wasn't supposed to be. It was supposed to be my first DP, but the guys decided to go for it. And so we just turned it into a double anal, double vaginal DP.
Nice.
And yeah. So I guess my specialties would include, I guess, anal. I've double anal and triple anal. I've done triple anal before. So the
that
double
sounds
anal.
Almost painful, though.
No, it's
no.
It's and impressive.
I guess I'm really well known for bisexual stuff as mm-hmm. well. So two guys that are interacting with me, the double anal. I guess I was very flattered, not this past year, but the year before at the AVN nomination party where they announce all of the nominees for all of the awards. I was saying hi to one of the directors that I hadn't worked with. I'd met him a couple times and he was on set while I was shooting one time. And he's really well known. His name is Chris Streams. He was working for Illegal Porno, Jules Jordan. And now he's a really big director for Evil Angel. And he came up to me and he says, listen, Evil just gave me this double anal project. So it's going to be a DVD with four scenes and it's going to be the first one of its kind. And you're the first on the list. We have to have you for it. And
oh
I was like,
oh my God, I would have cried.
Yeah. So in my career, I've done probably about 18 to 20 something double anal scenes. Probably a dozen or more gangbangs.
Nice.
Which like in comparison to like other people in the industry, they may only do like, if they ever do it at all, they may only do like a couple here or there.
Yeah, that's really cool.
But that's like your thing.
Yeah, nice. So, I love gangbangs, by the way. That's my favorite porn, and I want to have a gangbang one day.
You want to have a gangbang one day?
Yeah.
We'll make sure it happens. That'll be my gift to you. That
was
my 27th birthday gift. Yeah. He secretly organized a 16-man gangbang for me.
I feel like that's so romantic.
Yeah.
It's easier than you think.
I love that. Did he say it's easier than you think?
To organize 16 dudes to fuck your hot wife, yeah, I bet.
Is it easier than you think? Is that what you said?
Yeah, it's easier than you think. To find 18 or...
I don't know. Whenever I tried to organize a gangbang, it was always so difficult.
That's what I'm saying. Is like, I'm trying... It's hard enough getting guys to fuck me, like... Just one
he's
person.
Good
he's good at it.
You're like, I can't get anyone to throw me a bone. Let it be like that 16. Sometimes. Well, I will say that some cities have networks of people that like to do these things. So we had a friend who sort of had this network of guys that like to gangbang. So if you can get into that, that's
good. So thus far in your career, what has been your favorite scene to shoot? Tell us about it.
So far, like, what's been my most favorite scene to shoot?
Yes.
Any idea what that would be?
What about that oil one you just did for you?
Oh, okay. I can't say for certain because, all right, there's a lot of my favorite ones, and some of them you can't compare. It's like apples, bananas, oranges. Right,
you like them for different reasons.
Right, but one that comes to mind is actually, I'll tell you two instances.
Okay.
One was this scene that I did only a couple months ago. And it was my first time working for Bang Brothers, which was a big deal for me because, like, I had wanted to work for them for so long. Like, they were, you know, my bread and butter, right? So they had cast me in this scene with this other performer named Chris Diamond. And I had only recently met him just a little bit before that. And one of my good friends in the industry, Ramon Nomar, who notoriously has a very large penis and he's sexy. Yes, and he says, "Hey, Lisey, do you want to do a DP with my friend and I, Chris Diamond?" And I said, "Yeah, sure, that sounds good." And he's like, "Okay, we'll set it up." And when I get there, I had never met Chris before. I didn't even have time to look him up. And he says, "Hey, would you be able to do maybe a double anal today?" And I was like, "Yeah, no problem." And he's like, "Okay." He says, "But Chris is bigger than me." And I'm like, "Okay, whatever." And he's like, "Yeah, he really is." And he was like showering in the next room. I'm like, "All right, whatever." I was filling out the paperwork. And he comes out and I'm like, "What the fuck?" He always does these things where he compares it to his forearm.
Yeah.
And it's like, and so I was like, I'm going to do a double anal with these two guys that are very large, which I've done double anal with Ramon before, but not with Chris Diamond. And so it was pretty intense, but it was really fun, really amazing. And they're both so, so unbelievably sexy.
Yeah, that and has so to be a fun back. Part of porn. Oh, sorry. Annmarie said she needed a break.
Oh,
I don't know why.
She's going to play the clitar.
She's like, "I'm too turned on by this episode. I got to get out of here."
So my Bang Brothers scene was with Chris Diamond. And so I got to work with him one-on-one. And the director at the time, his name was Just Dave, and I had never worked with him. He was like, "Listen, I've never worked with either one of you guys, but you guys are legends. And what I want to do today is something that we've never, ever done before. It has to be epic." And I'm like, okay. And he said, "What we're going to do is we're going to take coconut oil in these big bottles and we're going to squirt it into your butthole. And we want you to rooster tail it out during the scene."
What
and
does I was that like, mean?
When you push it out and it like has this spray stream from your butt because they put oil in it, right?
Yeah, okay.
So I was like, "You know what? I bet that I could squirt at the same time if I hydrated enough." And so he was like, "Oh my God, could you do that?" And I said, "Yes." So we had this crazy scene covered in oil, head to toe, just like all these crazy positions. He's got this baby arm fucking me in the butt. He's putting oil in there and he's like, he's fucking me. And then I've got all this oil in there. And so then I'm spraying oil out of my butt, squirt out of my pussy. That's and he's amazing. Putting his face in it and just taking it all in and then like spitting it back on my face.
That's and the best.
It was intense. Yeah. It was one of those things where like you just put everything that you had into it and at the end you're like,
"What the fuck just happened?"
Yeah. That's yes. Crazy. And I guess the second scene I'll say is something that I did recently that was one of my own productions, and I'm so excited about it. It was this, I called it Hetero Chub Rubs Volume 1 Double Ass Jobs. And it was, so it was my own production. And it was, I do this beginning thing where it's this kind of like 90s filters with all of these bright popping colors. And then it's these two guys who are bisexual. But they are just kind of, their dicks are just rubbing each other in my ass crack. And so it kind of turns into this like whole slippery neon thing with these two super hot guys rubbing their dicks together.
That turned me on. It really does.
Honestly, yeah.
I want to look that up. And I think that's pretty common with women that like, men on men.
We call it a hetero chub rub, which I stole the term from Aiden Starr. But I'm actually making a second version of that that's going to have a little segment that I'm going to add to it that was, we did DP and double anal as well. So I'm going to call it double anal ass jobs.
Nice.
So I'm working on the edit right now.
That's awesome. So overall, how have people responded to you going into porn? Obviously, that had to have been a shocking transition.
This is the money question everybody always asks. How has people responded to your porn career, your family, everything? So I remember it was almost 3 years ago today that we told my dad, right? We decided to tell my dad on my birthday, which was also Father's Day. Actually, I told my stepmom who said it to my dad.
Aww.
And he was very upset. He kind of didn't talk to me for a long time. And he said a couple words here and there, but from what I can gather from my stepmom and everybody else in the family that he's still kind of upset about it. He said that he was upset that his friends knew before him and that it was kind of embarrassing, which, you know, it's my life.
Right, like get the fuck over it. Sorry, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Tell me, bro. We're not but, you nice know, about it. His mom, my grandmother, who I'm very close with, is very proud of me. One time she answered the phone saying, how's the most famous person in the family? Like, when I was nominated for all those awards last year, she was so proud of me. Awesome. If my mom was alive, I know she would be super proud of me. My sisters are supportive. My husband's family is very supportive. Awesome. So I'm lucky to not really have much negativity. I have seen like on Facebook, a lot of people who are friends with my parents seem to have opinions about it, but I don't really give a fuck.
Right. It's always the people whose like opinions you literally could not care less about who have the loudest ones. You're like, why are you talking?
It's not even that I don't care about their opinions. That's actually for me, and this is how I've always been, that's what fuels the fire. I've always loved to swim against the stream and do things that are out of the norm, challenge societal norms, and
And we love that.
I'm going to be happy.
Maybe our podcast isn't the same as porn, but it's definitely stirred up some stuff.
Yeah, we've had some drama of our own just from having a sex podcast, so I can't even imagine, you know, having to deal with those opinions.
Mostly going to Europe and having a gangbang of 8 people.
I love that.
So we actually asked Lisey to prepare a segment for us. Did you bring something for us for Weird Porn of the Week? Can we get into it?
Yeah, this is a no-brainer,
John,
yeah.
Cue the intro. Weird Porn of the Week. It's the Weird Porn of the Week. Porn of the Week. Porn of the Week. Porn of the Week. Get your dicks out and watch some porn.
Okay, so what is your weird porn?
So my weirdest porn is I was working for a company called Legal Porno, and to work for them I had to fly all the way to Prague. And they, if you don't know who Legal Porno is, they are a very extreme site, lots of extreme anal, double anal, things like that, of that nature. And I had never worked for them before. I got there, and the first scene that they had me do was just like a standard four-guy gangbang double anal scene. Just to kind of see, okay, just can standard, she handle this?
Like, that's just like,
let's right? Just this working is kind of like the test waters, because it's very, very intense. The whole time it's very intense there. So the director was very pleased with how my first scene did. So he says, I'm just going to, you know, let you go off the deep end here for the next scene. So I had a day in between, and then the next day, it was the scene that was eight guys, and then me and two other girls. And the girls didn't speak any English at all. They were both Russian. And all of the guys were either German or Czech or Russian. One of them spoke a little bit of English. The cameraman didn't speak any English at all. And then it was just Giorgio, who is the director. He's Italian, but he spoke English as well.
Good, at least.
So I'm kind of like in this whole thing, hardly anybody speaks English, but okay. And we were in this kind of like building in Prague that was a little basement-y looking.
Again.
But it was amazing. Like
these girl.
These guys were like super fucking hot, and the girls were super hot, right? And so, all right, here's the beginning of the scene. It was actually in two parts, part one and part two. So the beginning is me with my hands tied up, a rope from the ceiling, and the one girl acting as a dom is whipping me with a flogger. And the other girl is also a submissive, so me and the other girl are submissive, and there's the one dom. And so she's whipping us, and then she puts us on our backs on this table, and she starts fisting our buttholes in this punching bag side by side, right? The next part was they brought in just like one or two guys, and they were fucking the dom's butthole, and they came in her butthole, or one of the guys came in her butthole, and then the other sub sucked it out of her butthole and then blew it into my butthole with air, and then I farted it in her face. That was part one.
Oh my God.
So part two was, now everybody was involved. There was eight guys and then me and the other two girls, and all three of us girls were doing double anal in different positions, either on the edge of a couch, on the other edge of a couch, or on the floor in front. And so we would just kind of circle through all of these people, and then the other two guys would sort of flank, getting their dick sucked here and there, wherever they could do it. And so then the end comes along, and the girl who is the dom, she gets in doggy position, and all eight guys take their turns coming in her butt. But I was underneath her with my mouth open, catching all of these loads, and I had to hold it in my mouth until all eight loads were finished. So they'd come one at a time, unload
in her
time.
Butt,
and
oh my
then
God.
She would squeeze it out into my mouth, and now I'm here like holding eight full loads in my mouth. And then I spit it into the other girl's mouth, and we were kind of cum swapping.
Yeah.
But we gave it back to that submissive girl, and she swallowed it.
Nice. That's pretty wild.
And it's every time I watch the trailer for it, I gag. But he masturbated to it before.
Yeah,
I could masturbate to that.
He still gags.
No, I could definitely masturbate to that.
It was a very intense
scene. Yeah,
you
probably have.
No,
I
honestly.
I think that we shot for like 5 hours.
Wow.
And most of it was fucking. And I remember, like, as we were getting towards the end, I cut and I was like shaking. And I said, hey, guys, like, I'm kind of reaching my physical limit here.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to ask. Like, physically,
and
how
they
do
were
you
like,
handle
okay.
that?
They were like, cool, we're just going to do one more minute to do the transition and then we'll do the end. And I was like, perfect. And so I remember when they were driving me back to my hotel afterwards, like I got into my hotel, I got in the shower and I started crying. And I was like so proud of myself that I did all of that. Like I never thought that I could do something like that. And I was like, so the fact that I was just able to push myself to the limit and
that's
get something that was like for hours, it was just amazing.
Yeah, that's
amazing,
really impressive,
theory.
Honestly.
Impressive.
So do you have any favorite people that you've worked with? Anyone that you like are particularly fond of doing films with?
My favorite people to work with. I do, but I don't want to be exclusionary, but I'll just name some people off the top of my head right now. I work with Ramon Nomar a lot. He's very sexy and fun, and I like working with him. Colby Jansen is actually a gay performer, and we've done some bisexual work before, quite a few scenes actually. And we were nominated for Best Bisexual Scene together.
Oh, nice.
Actually, me and Ramon were nominated too. For his best DP. And let's see, who else do I love working with? I love working with Isaiah Maxwell. I love working with Dredd, who has...
I know who Dredd is. He's got a huge dick. Absolutely massive dick.
I worked with Dredd somewhat recently, and I was just putting my hand around his dick because I can only fit like a little bit in my mouth, right? I can fit the whole thing in my butt. But I was like trying to measure the thickest part by putting my hands around it.
Yeah.
And there was still like this much space in between my middle finger and thumb.
Oh,
and so I measured, and he's about like this thickness on my forearm.
Yeah.
And I was like, that was in my butt for like a couple hours.
That's insane. So,
nice.
If it was regular size, mine would be as big as a Tylenol.
So I was joking with him. I said, if Dredd's cock was regular size, his cock would be the size of a Tylenol. I was joking, of course.
No, but honestly, well, Dredd, he has a huge dick.
Yeah,
like,
it's kind of like,
I love
it's
it.
Impressive.
It's
yeah,
bigger than, I like, I compare it with my face, and it's bigger than my head.
I love that, honestly. I get so many dick pics. Like, I, on our show, explicitly request dick pics. And so, recently, some guy slid into my DMs. He made a Twitter just for his dick. It's literally called like 12 plus inches. And I was like, oh, so what's up? Like, you're going to show me that dick then? And he did. And it was really like the biggest dick I've ever seen. I don't even know how you fit that all down your throat.
Do you just not? I will say that I'm skeptical because there are a lot of guys out there that make fake accounts and just take these pictures like of porn performers or whatever. Oh. And then they'll pretend it's them. So
yeah,
heads up. That happens a lot. I don't know what is wrong with people.
You're like, no, I know that dick. I've worked with that
dick. That actually happened before.
There was
somebody that we were talking to, and they were sending me pictures, and I was like, that ain't you. I was like, I know that dick, and that ain't you.
That's hilarious.
So funny. I'm like, do you really believe that you're Johnny Sins?
Right. Oh, and he's a really popular performer as well, isn't he? So it's like...
He is. Actually, so I've never worked with him before, but we've talked and we've, chatted quite a bit. He's actually from Pittsburgh.
Oh, really?
So he's from our neck of the woods.
That's interesting.
And he's so sweet. He's the sweetest guy you'll ever meet.
That's awesome. I love that. Have you ever met... Okay, here are my three favorite male porn stars. Number one is King Nasir. Number two is Ricky Johnson, and number three is James Dean. He was a classic.
Okay. I don't know King Nasir.
Okay.
You said Ricky Johnson.
Yes.
And James Dean. Yeah, so I've worked with Ricky several times.
I've worked with
James once, and James, I really like him. We had such an amazing scene for his site called analyze.com, mm-hmm. and I'd always wanted to work with him, and he was great. We really kind of took it to a level that was awesome. Intense.
Yeah, he seems to foster a lot of trust in the people he works with. Like, he seems respectful, which is hard in that kind of porn that he does.
The one thing that's really nice is that James Dean is a very well-known performer. And I always love that every time I see him at events that he like comes up to me, hugs me, says, Lisey, how you doing? Like, he's really remembers the people that he works with. And he's just like a kind guy. Cause sometimes you'll work with people and they'll be like, they'll pretend that they don't remember you, or they'll be like, whatever. It's like a pissing contest or a dick measuring contest.
Right. Like, oh, who are you?
Yeah. I've worked with Ricky a few times. He was actually part of my first gangbang that was for kink.com. He was my master in that one.
I'm gonna look up all of these, by the way, now that I know it.
She's so excited.
I am.
How about you, Annmarie? Who are your favorite porn stars?
Oh my god, I don't know if I have a favorite. Well, I've been actually on the hunt for a man. Because I stumble upon him all the time.
I'm
so fucking into like masturbating that like I'll be like, I'm gonna look at what that guy's name is when I'm like done coming, you know? And then I just close out of the browser and I'm fucked. But he has like a tattoo sleeve on one arm, and he's like a dude. And he has like hair that's like this lengthish. But like he can really fucking throw it back, whoever he is. And dear God, trying to Google him.
Is it Ruffin?
I got in on it. I was like, Google.
She doesn't know. She has no idea.
Why don't you, if you can find one of the videos, send it to me and I'll see if I can figure it out. Because I know a lot of people. I've done like maybe almost 300 scenes.
Nice.
Maybe like 250 scenes.
How much cum do you think you have personally handled? Like if we had to put it into gallons.
Oh my God. They said, how much cum do you think I've personally handled if you were to like put it all in one container?
Oof.
No, I think you could fill an Olympic swimming pool.
Fuck yeah.
You have more cells that way than all the rest of your body.
What's that?
More semen cells than any other cell in your body.
He says, I have more semen cells than any other cell in my body.
Aw, how sweet.
So I actually have some questions about your relationship, if that's okay. So does being
absolutely.
In porn, like, does it affect your relationship at all?
So she asked, does being in porn affect our relationship at all? Hmm. And I don't know if you want to answer.
Can they hear me?
Can you hear him?
Yeah.
Yep.
It's affected us, obviously, mostly positive. Everything I can think of is positive. We're more free with our sexual life. We're more open and straight with each other. The only thing I could ever say that's negative, sometimes you just come home too sore to go again.
But, I was going to ask.
I think it's kind of improved our sex life in general, just because it's made us more exploratory and open.
Okay, that's interesting. I would have been worried that it would have like negatively affected it in the sense that like you wouldn't have fun in your personal life as much. No. Yeah,
so she was worried that it would negatively affect us, like we wouldn't have fun in our personal life.
It's like you're just fucking all the time.
What she does on. That we don't tend to do in our personal life for the most part,
right?
Except for some things, obviously.
Yeah, I try to explain to some people that what I do often on set is more of like a circus act, and it's not what I would do for pleasure.
Right.
So that's kind of one of the things about it is that the whole reason we do this is because this is the life that we want to live, and on set, off set, I'm the same person. And this is who we are. I've had directors be like, you're like the old school porn stars. You're here because you like to fuck. And they all love him. They love us. And it's great. I do have to say sometimes, a lot of times I'll be home exhausted now that I'm getting a little older, right? sometimes I come home, like my body's sore. I'm a little exhausted. I like to really put everything I've got into every scene I do. So oftentimes when I get home, I'm pretty wiped out. Or I could be sore. I've noticed over the years, the more I allow myself to enjoy the scene, the less pain I have later.
That makes sense.
So in the faster recovery time. I don't know. I don't think I need much recovery time now, but I usually can't come home from a scene and be like, all right, let's balls to the wall. But sometimes I can.
That's why I don't want you to always talk about your scene right away, because then it gets me going. And
yeah.
You're like,
how was it? And if I give him the details, he'll be like,
I don't want to know about it.
Yeah, but we have had times where I was on set all day, and then we would go out and we brought home several people.
Yeah.
So that's happened before.
That's fun. I love that.
Yeah, so we live the lifestyle. It's
That's
part of
pretty.
It for us.
So what would you say about the industry as a whole? Obviously, some people have negative experiences in the porn industry, but you seem to have had a generally positive one.
So, I know that the industry kind of gets a bad rap, mm-hmm. that a lot of people think that a lot of the girls are doing it because they have to or because they need money, or even some people go as far as to think that people are being forced into it or forced to do things that they want to. And I mean, I can speak in my experience, and I have a good agency, and I've not really had any bad experiences. And I do believe that that kind of situation is a thing of the past. Our industry is very professional. We pay our taxes just like everyone else. Mm-hmm. And what I kind of determined from talking to people along the way is that the porn industry used to kind of be run by the mob. Some people are saying that that was the case. So I guess it could be deduced that some of the things may have been a little, you know, pressure type of situation, mm-hmm. but it's not really like that anymore. We've got advocacy, we've got guidelines. There are recourse that we can have. We have no lists. If there's somebody that you don't want to work with, they go on your no list. If you show up on set and something happens, you don't have to do it. You call your agent or you say, I'm not comfortable with this. There have been a lot of times, oftentimes on set, where I have to say, stop, I'm not comfortable with this, mm-hmm. or I don't want to do this, or don't want to do that. But the whole point is, a lot of the things that I'm doing is to try to push to the limit, and that is what I signed up to do.
Right.
So when I'm given a scene, my agent will call me and say, hey, this company wants to book you for a double anal gangbang. Here's the rate, and then I'll find out the talent and everything. So then I can say, oh, I don't want to work with that person, or anything I want to in advance. And I mean, they can't force me to do anything.
Right.
I've never had anybody. There's a lot of companies are really good with compliance. One of the best is kink.com, because they are BDSM in nature.
That makes me happy. I watch a lot of those videos.
I have a lot of people, because I do some lectures at a college nearby, and I've done some stuff on NPR, and a lot of people have a lot of questions about ethical porn. And as far as that goes, I would say if you're looking from a lot of the mainstream companies, there's going to be no problem except for some little things here and there. But kink does a really good job at what they do is, as soon as we get on set, we know what we're doing, and I fill out this packet, and it's like a packet, right, of all the things I want to do and I don't want to do. I can explain myself, and then me and the director will go off and sit in a different room and go over it and talk about it. And then we bring all the other talent in, and then we talk about it, and it's all filmed. So like all of this consent and everything, right. We talk about our safe words and things that we don't like and how to get out of things, and they constantly check in. The nice thing about working for kink is that they're never like filming for very long segments. And even when I'm in like rope bondage, suspended from the ceiling, being waterboarded by somebody, upset by my ankles, you know, I'm not up there for very long. They're constantly like, are you okay? Do we need to bring you down? There's assistants on set, like waiting with a towel to hold me and massage my shoulders and feed me water through a straw. Like,
good.
It's like the pampered treatment. So
that's good.
It's always been really good.
I'm glad to hear that, honestly, because I have heard, and I guess that they probably are from people who used to do porn a lot longer ago. But I know that I used to read stories about people who just had to like be super drugged up or really drunk in order to do certain scenes, or people who were pushed past their limits and felt like they were being abused. And so I'm glad to hear that things have kind of changed. I think that like that as we normalize sex a little bit more in our society, that it becomes easier to put regulations and things in place to protect porn stars, porn actresses and actors. Yeah.
Well, I think one of the difficult things is I think that occasionally you can still see people showing up to set drunk or like using drugs. I've maybe seen it once or twice, and it's not tolerated on set. The director will say, you got to leave and you're never working for us again, or you're blacklisted from this company. I've heard reports of people being sent home because they're drunk. And I think that sometimes where that comes from is just the discomfort of what they're doing in general. Mm-hmm. I think it's like, because there's such a stigma. And
yes.
I mean, I entered the industry at 27. So I had a little bit of, mm-hmm. you know, lifestyle under my belt, but I can't even imagine the nerve of doing it when I was 18.
And yeah, I can't either.
Just the things that go through your head, you're put on this pedestal, and everybody's constantly criticizing your body, what you look like. She's too fat. She's got cellulite. She looks ugly. What's that snaggle tooth? Like, it's constant from the fans. And I even actually had one time where I was on set for a company and I showed up and they were like, you're a little hippier than we thought you would be. Like, your hips are too big and we need to take pictures to get you approved because we're going to have to send you home probably. Because
which is insane because you're a really thin woman as it is, I would say.
Well, I would consider myself definitely a curvy model. I'm not thin by any means. And so the thing was that they felt like they were being lied to about how big I was. And they thought that it would ruin the image of the company to have a girl that with curves on the brand. And so then they were like, well, we have to shoot you. We already have everybody here. And now I'm ready to do the scene, like almost in tears. Like they just called me fat in front of this crew of like a lot of people. I was very upset. I talked to my agent about it for a lot, but you know, in the end I was like, well, you know what? Fuck that. I like how I am. I'm not going to change my body. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to let them control the way that I think, and I don't have to work for them again.
Okay, so do all of the guys from our hometown like creep on your porn?
I do. You know, when I kind of was first starting and I was still doing cams on the side too, I would have a lot of them pop into my rooms and be like, hey, and they would use my real name. And I was like, not cool,
Come on, bro.
Don't do that.
And I did notice that a lot of them subscribe and they'll try to reach out to me here and there, which
right
cool
what yeah else? That's awesome.
But yeah, I guess I did have quite a bit of people reach out to me, and I think that I've also noticed that it seems like a lot of people know, but a lot of people are nervous to approach me about it or ask anything, and like it's this weird subject for them to talk about, but I'm always like an open book. I love talking about it.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming and talking to us about everything because it's really cool to hear it from that perspective, and especially as someone who loves watching porn and watches probably too much porn. It's nice to talk to you about it and to see that people are actually enjoying it, because I do worry sometimes, you know, like I don't want to be like unintentionally exploiting people in my masturbation. So it's really cool to hear from your perspective and just to see that like the industry isn't necessarily what everyone thinks that it is.
Yeah. So I mean, there are some people you'll find. Go ahead. Sorry.
No, you go.
I said you will find some people that don't like to talk about it. I've had some friends in the industry that like would rather not have people reach out to them. You know, our mutual friend, Lulu Kramer, sometimes she gets upset if people try to reach out to her like real persona.
Yes.
And I understand that because it is kind of an invasion of privacy at times, but.
Right. You keep those worlds separate on
sometimes,
purpose.
Sometimes, yeah, you want to keep them separate. Exactly. Yeah. I have welcomed it into my personal world by posting pictures of us on the red carpet, mm-hmm. talking about nominations on my personal pages, just because it's something that I'm really proud of.
Yeah.
But there is a line. There is a line when people try to approach you in a way that is your professional persona from your personal mm-hmm. accounts, and that's right. kind of inappropriate.
Right, and especially people who probably, like, come in, like, I want you to, like, show me your naked body. I knew you in high school.
I've had a lot of people, like, send me nudes. We knew each other in high school. And in some ways, I'm like, sorry. Do I want to, like, keep these? No, just kidding.
You should. That's so funny.
So people. We actually prepared something for you as well. You brought us a weird porn. We actually brought something for you as well.
Oh.
Because we're so happy you took time to visit our
show. Like it's some gift. So
we're going to do another segment called Kill, Fuck, Marry. I'm sure you're familiar.
Kill, Fuck, Marry.
Yeah.
The intro.
Play the intro.
Fuck Mary.
Welcome to WKFM, where we're out here killing, fucking, and marrying bitches.
Okay, so kill, fuck, marry. So the first one I have for you today is Bernie Sanders, because, well, he's just like a fucking Bernie sex Sanders. Machine. The second one I have is Hugh Hefner, rest in peace.
Hugh Hefner.
Okay. And the third one is Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister of Canada.
Justin Trudeau.
You gotta kill one.
Fuck Mary. Mary at
one.
Bernie, Hugh, and Justin. I'm trying to think of like what I would do.
I would say kill Hugh Hefner only because he's already dead.
Aww.
So
well, that seems fair.
He rest in peace.
Way. Yeah.
I don't want to kill anybody, so that one's an easy one.
Right.
Now fucking marry Bernie Sanders, Justin Trudeau.
Why don't you marry Hugh Hefner? He's rich.
Yeah, you said why don't you marry Hugh Hefner? He's rich. That's, oh man. See, yeah, I just think too much into this.
So that money's already yours.
Okay, all right, let me change it. How about I marry. All right, here's how we're going to do it. Okay, I'm going to marry Hugh Hefner because he's rich, right? Yeah. And I'm going to kill Bernie Sanders, and only because I feel like from somebody who likes to, indulge in Bernie's ideals, is that it would make him a martyr and it would make our side just come together and be strong, right?
He's already close to death, too.
And he's already close to death, too, because he's old. And then I would, then I would fuck Justin Trudeau because he wouldn't hit that.
He's so hot.
You haven't seen his ass? He's like,
oh my god, his ass! Yes, thank you!
I mean, to be fair, I could make an exception for her because she's so, like, she's a, like, a pro. She could probably fuck all three, to be honest.
I could fuck all three at the same time. Yeah.
That's actually
make this bitch airtight.
Before or after you kill him.
He said before or after I kill him.
That's the 4G I want.
Either
way.
That
is.
Bro.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show today. I think that's all we have for you.
Do you have anything for us or for the fans before you go? Do you want to tell us any super hot sex tips? How can we get better at it?
Just enjoy yourself. Don't let society tell you what to do. I live outside the norm of society, and look, I live a happy, happy life, and I get to do what I want, and I live pleasure.
I love it.
So that is my tip. Just live your life. Fuck everyone else. And if you want, only if you want to.
I will fuck everyone else. Thank you.
And then if you guys don't mind, I'm going to do a shameless plug.
Yes, we would love you to.
Yes.
So if you guys follow my social media, I've got Twitter and Instagram is the Lisey Sweet.
We can actually link it right in the bio.
Yeah, we'll put the description.
Yes, but the Lisey Sweet.
Yeah.
And then I also have an OnlyFans that it has, oh man, it's got like 300 videos on it, almost 600 photos. It's really awesome. And I do tons of giveaways all the time. Lots of nude in public, fucking strangers, whatever, all this crazy stuff on there. And I also have a website called theleseysweet.com.
Very cool.
All in the description for you guys to click on, check out her hot videos.
And I'm going to be looking up the Ricky Johnson and the James Dean porn.
She's like, we have to go.
I'm ready.
I know. I'm so excited to see you guys. I haven't seen you guys since we were in high school together.
I know. Honestly. Crazy. It would be cool to meet up sometime. We should plan something. But not right now. Not
right now. Yeah.
Like Corey gone wild.
Oh, boy.
It's always been wild. People just didn't know.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's everything in the world, though. Like, everyone's kind of a freak. They just don't want to admit to it. Okay.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. Maybe we'll bring you back sometime if you're really busy for us.
I would love that. Okay. I will always make time for you guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
You're welcome.